I'm going to be demoing, giving you a little practical demonstration of how to use a free software toolchain to manage and edit your digital photos. I'm going to be using two free software applications. One of them is GIMP, which perhaps you all are familiar with. First of all, let me introduce myself. I'm Jeff Steiner. I work for Laval as a graphic artist, but this talk will be about my hobby, which is photography. So I'm not using this professionally, but I still depend on it. The editing part of most of my editing I do in GIMP. But also when you're shooting digital photos, you need to have some sort of way to manage your library. For a long time, I've just depended on the file system and organized my photos into a structure based on events and perhaps fine grain by dates and stuff. But it wasn't really managing as much as stuffing things and trying to find them. So an application, F-Spot, helps greatly to manage your photos. The workflow usually begins with having a camera full of photos that you want to get into your library. I didn't bring all the cables that I need, so I can't demo that part, but we can just simulate. We can just simulate this by importing, or how that would look, by importing from a local directory. So let's see. We've wasted too much time, so I really don't know what kind of images are in here. Okay, some not very. This never happens. It has some artificial intelligence. There were some very embarrassing photos, and it saved me from that embarrassment. So let's try a different folder. Graphics local. Okay, so when you would attach a camera, you would import the photos, or a card reader, you would import. If you have your environment in GNOME set up correctly, it would bring up this management application and get you to this dialog. From the import dialog, we can actually tag your photos. Tags are just means to organize your photos as opposed to having them structured in a file system. It's a very useful way to query or find stuff. So theoretically, when you just came back from a photo shoot, you may have the option to tag your photos directly because they're all from the same location, for example. So if I would return from Montreal, I would just tag them in Montreal. The good thing is it's got this kind of it feels not very visual way of adding tags, but it's really useful because it allows you to like autocomplete existing tags. I don't really remember pressing. So if you tab, it will automatically complete the tags that you already have. If you put in new tags, it will create them if they weren't needed. So it's very transparent and neat. But usually, I shoot JPEG, which I'll come back to that later. And so usually I leave my card gets full after lots of sessions, so usually I don't tag when I import. I tag after I import, which is another thing. When you have the photos, you can categorize them by adding tags to them. Again, there's multiple ways to do that. There's a very visual way that I'm going to skip because you can really associate a tag with an image, and you have a nice editor to pick a certain part of an image, to have it visually clear what it is. But the usefulness of tags for me is, even though they're flat, well, they can be categorized, but I really just use flat set of tags, because it's just so much easier to select an image, and just by hitting the T key, I get this the same kind of interface, and I can just start, typing words that I see on the image, and not really think about it much. Structure sounds, like a good thing that you could, if you have an image of a car passing, it's an Audi, to tag it as an Audi, which is a subcategory of a car, so that when you query for a car, you would get the Audi automatically, even though you only tag it Audi. But in reality, I just see an image to just describe it, so I have both Audi and car, just flat set of tags, and my queries will work exactly the same way, and I will find the stuff as easily. I'm using at home, I have a library of over 35,000 images, and it's still very snappy. Well, snappy. It's very usable to query this kind of large library. So that was the tagging part, which is kind of boring if you already have a large library of photos and then you have to manually tag your photos. But sometimes you just have half an hour that kind of free time. You guys all have lots of free time, and it's kind of fun to go back. And there's a nice timeline slider at the top of the window, and you can go back in time. This computer only has 102 photos because it's a tiny hard drive. But it's kind of fun to go back, and then you tag, and while you're tagging, you're actually looking at stuff that you've done 3 years ago and realize that you've been to places you don't even remember. Tagging a library is a time-consuming effort, but it really helps you. You will get the reward afterwards when you quickly meet something, and then you just type. The other good part of having a managed library of photos is that you can search for them. Again, there are visual ways where you could drag tags to this search bar, and you could even compose more complex queries, find photos tagged like this or like that. But the way I tag my library, this kind of interface does not scale for large amounts of tags. So F-Spot has a much better way to query. You, just like in Firefox, you hit the forward slash, and you can tag the stuff. So for example, I could, and also, tab autocompletes your query, tag, so you can easily get a feedback of if you misspell stuff. So you don't have to type all that much, and you can do more complex queries. And it updates immediately. And it's not completely slow when, if you have 35,000 images. It's kind of nice. So that's how you find stuff, and how you categorize stuff. But then F-Spot also has a set of basic editing tools. So for example, this is a bug in the theme. So for example, you could fix the exposure of the image. You have like basic sliders to control exposure, or you could fix white balance. That's another thing that I usually fix directly in the piece of software. And the good thing is that although it's not super smart, it does create a copy of the image if you do any sort of editing. So then you get a chance to go back to the original image and just create a copy of the JPEG that you're working on. But usually there are things, so what kind of things can F-Spot do right out of the box? There's like some auto auto color fixes, which kind of fixes the exposure, the white balance, and everything. There's effects like if you wanna do portraits and you want the subject to gain all the attention, there's a way to. Okay, it's broken in here. You can like blur the edges, but apparently there's a bug for tilted, rotated images. You can fix the horizon, but it's again done just with a slider, which is not very intuitive. GIMP has much better tools to control it precisely. You can create sepia, blah blah blah. I'm not going to go into that because I usually do most of my editing in GIMP. To do that, it's very easy. You can either drag a thumbnail from the browse view of your library, or even easier is there's a context menu, and that allows you to just open the image with whatever is associated with that file type on your system. F-Spot asks whether you want to create a copy for that action. In most cases, you do, so I would think that this dialogue is unnecessary, but so we, I actually wanted to use a different image. I'm going to go for an image. I hope you can still see bits of me. I'm going to go for an image that's made with a phone camera. Which is this. What you can see is the sky is having all the detail, but the shadows are quite dark, so we want to like boost the shadows, bring up the shadows a little more. So I'm gonna do the same thing, open it in GIMP. And what you probably noticed that my widget theme is some sort of a dark, it's got dark colors. That's because when you're editing photos, it's kind of nice to have the image be the central part and not the widgets to take the, it's like looking at the night sky, the stars, while there's a big lamp shining next to you, and versus complete darkness when you're looking from some forest or something, well, forest, there's trees, some non-light populated, polluted place. So I like to work when I'm editing photos. I like to work full screen. GIMP allows to, again, if you've been to my previous talk, there was. The big issues I had with window management. So GIMP has to have like different quirks to work around how different window managers behave, but you can usually set it in the preferences so that you can work full screen, and it's not just for previewing your artwork, but so that the palettes are accessible, so that they're above the window. For example, for Metacity, it looks like this. You know, you have utility windows, and that's about it. I think that's the default even. I don't know. But there's, like, depending on your window manager, these settings change. So I like to work full screen, and you can also notice that I bring, by default, GIMP does not show the menu at full screen, but I like that because I can quickly access functions that I don't use all that often to put a shortcut there, but they're accessible with the mnemonics. So for example, if I would do some color collection, I can just press Alt-C, and then, for example, levels, and it allows, because it's multi-level, you know, every item in the menu is accessible with such a mnemonic. So we can learn the sequences of keystrokes and get the same thing as with shortcuts. So what we're gonna do here, I'm gonna create a duplicate of the layer, and I'm gonna use the regular curves tool, which again is in the color menu, so it's LCC, and I'm just gonna boost the, first thing we want to do, I only want to boost the dark parts. I don't want the change that I'm gonna, you know, lighten up the image. I don't want this to happen for the sky or for the light things, because I would lose detail, you know, it would get clipped. I'm only working at the 8-bit per channel color space, which, you know, for this kind of stuff is not ideal, so we need to work around that limitation. So I'm going to create a layer mask, which is something that limits or that affects what pixels are going to be transparent when the image is composited. By default, it just creates a light opacity mask, which means that all the pixels will be fully opaque. On the other hand, if the mask is black, the pixels correlating to the mask would be completely transparent. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go for a grayscale copy of a layer, so that if it was like this, all the dark areas would be more transparent and all the light areas would be more opaque, but I want exactly the opposite. I want the light areas to be more opaque. I want the dark areas to be more opaque and hide all the light areas. To preview how the mask looks, you can control Alt click on the image. So this is how the mask looks. This is very close to white. So I would be completely opaque, or the layer will be shown while the sky is not. But I want to go even more extreme, and I would use the levels tool, which is another very useful tool. And I will really. Make the sky make the sky completely transparent. There's some clouds here still, so I can use the rectangular selection and fill it with black, so I get pretty much what I wanted. So the sky, whatever I do to the layer, only this bit that's below is going to be affected. So I can actually, if I control click on the layer, on the mask, I can see the original layer without the mask applied. So you can see when I will do just the curves thing, when I'm going to boost the shadows, you know, you can see that I've blown out the sky in here. But if I toggle on the mask again, you can see this intact. You can preview what you've done by clicking on the visibility of the layer, so that you can see I'm only I've only worked on the darker bits. So I've boosted the shadows and not affected the highlights. Also, in this image, another thing that's kind of bothersome is that it's a JPEG, and then there's a there's a phone camera, and it's quite considerable noise. And it's especially, there's some texture on the actual image, but the sky looks, you can actually see it on the projector, which doesn't show much detail. So we're going to get rid of it. One option, I mean, there's many plugins even for GIMP that allow to get rid of noise, like the very sophisticated resynthesizer plugin, but they all take too much time. There's a quicker way to use a filter that's distributed by default. It's called selective Gaussian blur. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy the basic layer, because we're going to work on the sky only. So we're going to use the same mask, except now it's going to be inverted so that we don't affect the dark areas, or only affect the sky. To do that, it's just a regular procedure of selecting, copying, and we go here, and we add new layer mask. Is there a copy of selection? No. Okay, so white, and I paste the selection.
It's copy of selection.
Well, it's a selection. I want the RGB data. The selection was the complete image. I would have to. And I'm going to invert the layer mask color, so that if you shift click on the eye, it will like solo that layer, so that it turns off all the other layers, so we can see that it actually does what we wanted. So we have the sky here, and I'm going to apply the filter, which is called selective Gaussian blur. Whoops, not you. Filters, blur, selective Gaussian blur. Selective Gaussian blur is pretty much a regular. Whoops, another problem. Selective Gaussian blur is pretty much the regular Gaussian blur, except it does take edges and detail into consideration. It only blurs like homogeneous areas. So you have the blur radius, which in this case we're going to put 20. You can see that I'm kind of fuzzy, although we're masking that out, that this won't be shown anyway. But usually it works like something around the same blur radius that the max delta value is usually somewhere around the, just worked for me. So I apply this, and you can see that I don't really see anything, why it's if it's doing something when I'm in full screen mode. Of course, if I would be in the regular mode, I would see it in at the bottom. But I just assigned a shortcut to view the status bar where the progress bar is being from. Just show status bar here, so I have it assigned to F9. I can see that's crunching. This is pretty slow, but it's still faster than all the other noise reduction filters that I've tried, and it gives reasonable results. So that's that. Let's just wait for the result. What else? In the meantime, I can show you. Okay, so we're done. But so this is a phone cam image, and it's pretty decent for a phone cam image. So I'm going to close that. Oh, if I save it, because I've used layer mask, layers, which JPEG, of course, doesn't do. That's why it bothers me about asking to export. F-Spot doesn't actually figure out that the image updated, so I have to fix it up like that. But I still have the original. Oops, I tested this before for the demo, so I have a couple of versions here. But you can get to the original quickly, which was actually I made it bad so that I could demo it. It wasn't that bad. Okay. So we have a good image made bad and then fixed. Another thing I'm going to show you is we're going to work from a flower. I think it's a flower. No, flower blue. Oops. Maybe I didn't even tag it, so just do it visually. So if you don't tag stuff, there we go. Okay, number. Okay. So we're going to do the same thing. Open in GIMP. And yes, we do want to create a new layer. So we have, this is a high resolution image from a digital SLR. For a flower like that, we want to, you have it very powerful. That's the other thing that's coming in the new GIMP, is that when you're doing color correction, you usually want the device to be calibrated so that you don't actually damage your image because your display is not calibrated. But let's just go wild and do color tweaks on a non-calibrated display. I'm gonna go and make the colors more vivid. The simple way is just to boost saturation. There's a saturation tool, and you could already do that in F-Spot. Saturation. I don't really have it turned on in the toolbar because I only have tools that I use. So it's in colors, and there's view saturation. So you could boost saturation completely, but it's working on the whole. It's kind of, there's a better way to boost the colors, which I'm going to show you. What we're going to do is mimic the look of a Fuji Velvia film, sort of, digitally. It's done by using, in GIMP it can be done by using a very powerful tool, a filter, which is called Channel Mixer. It's very popular for people who do black and white photography because it gives them absolute control of how they want the black and white image to be composed of the three channels that RGB gives them. But it's also good for situations like these, where the trick to emulate the Velvia look is to boost. So what you have here in the channel mixer is you have your input, you have your input channels in here, and you mix them into the output channel. So you can borrow, information from, say, another use case would be you have a red stain on a table carpet, so usually, red wine, would have the stain on the right channel. So you could borrow from the other channel and then perhaps just fix it up with the clone tool or something. What we're going to do is for each of the channels, you can see that, 100% red goes to the red channel, 100% green goes to the green channel, and 100% blue goes to the blue channel. So we didn't make any changes, but we can boost red and go 120. So we have more, we have 20% more red, but in that case, we would change the luminosity of the image if we would boost this for all the channels. So what we're going to do is we're going to go minus 10 for the other two channels. Do that for the green channels. So we're going to do 20% more green, 10% less red, 10% less blue. Same thing for the blue channel. We're going to use 10% less red and green, and 120% of. Okay, so we're done. So you can see that the colors are more vivid. But this kind of thing is very very hard to do if you want to experiment how much you want to add. So it only took me a complete day to write a Python filter to do this. It sounds really trivial, but not for everybody. You can just have a Bellevue filter so that I can define the and it's combined with, it's combined with a contrast filter, because sometimes you want to add. Now we can add contrast to get the same thing. So what it does is just pulls the same filter and then, contrast. So it was that. Vignetting, we want to bring the flower more, make it more apparent and not care about the background that much. Vignetting, usually you want to get rid of vignetting. This time I actually want to add it. I'm going to create a new layer. I'm going to just use the elliptical tool to create a selection. For some reason it takes a long time on this image. Invert it, fill it with black, and then get rid of the selection and filter it. Use regular Gaussian blur on it. Filter blur, Gaussian blur, and go overboard, because it's a 6 megapixel image, so I'm going to go with 500. Yes, do it, okay. And it's going to take a while. It's perhaps too much. You can also experiment with either just the opacity, or there's different blending modes. There's overlay that works very well for this kind of stuff, or soft light, which is kind of nice too. Which is kind of a good time to demo another thing. GIMP supports. GIMP supports nifty input devices, not only tablets, but devices like this, which is just a USB, pretty much a mouse with just one axis and a button, and it can be used pretty much for anything. What you can do with the UI, it's really handy to have a physical device to do things. For example, at home, I have an action to save the current document and a PNG copy when I push this. It's very, very nifty. And for this demo, it's in the GIMP preferences. The development version actually has a human readable interface to select the device. So there's Griffin PowerMate, which is that's what the maker and the product is called. You just select it, and then you can select what sort of action you want for the event. If you push it, if you don't know what sort of event it does, you can just click here, grab event, and then push it, and it's going to select whatever event that triggered. So what you can see here is that I have button 1 assigned to mask toggle, and I have assigned to decrease and increase layer opacity when I rotate it. So it actually, okay, a small thing. So what, I just quick overview what the channel mask is just a representation of your selection where you can see all the levels of selection, because you can have not only fully selected or unselected pixels, you can also have something in between. So if I push this, and then I use just regular paint tools, and then I release it, I get a nice selection, and it's kind of useful because you can even apply filters on the quick mask. But no, that's not what I wanted. But also, it's useful if you have a layer like this, and I can just rotate the stain, and it will decrease or increase the opacity. And it's also nice like for painters where they can paint with a tablet, and while they're painting, they can enlarge or decrease the size of a brush while they're painting, or in the meantime. But it's really nice to have a physical device, and it's not only these USB devices. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm sorry. I thought it's my voice.
Okay.
So, is it real? I kind of like my distorted voice. So much wiser. Where was I? So you can preview how much of the effect you can do, which is what I'm going to do now. I'm going to merge this a little, hopefully. What's it now? The next thing I'm going to do is also something very common, and that's sharpening the image. There's many ways that you can do GIMP, provides many filters. Most common filter is something called Unshark Mask. But while this image is not very grainy, it will still enhance the noise as well as the edges of regular objects. So people have come up with nice processes to, for example, only work and sharpen only the luminosity channel, for example, so that you don't fiddle with, because there's some color shifts as well. Also, what the human visual system is considering a sharp image really happens only on the edges of objects. So another thing is to create a selection that only that only the edges of objects are selected. But it's a kind of tedious task. We would have to first decompose the image to a color space such as in a lab to work on the luminosity channel, or HSV to work on the value channel, and then filter the value channel, then and of course just first create the selection of the edges. There's an edge filter, but then you would first need to create a channel, run the edge detection filter to get the channel, switch back to selection, run the filter to unshark mask the image, and then composite the image back to the starting state. So it's kind of tedious. So people have created scripts that those enhance and sharpen. And this one is kind of nice. Sharpen. Filters, enhance, smart sharpen. We're going to be smart. It pretty much has all the sliders that the unsharp mask are values that the parameters that the unsharp mask does. It says the radius of the sharpening, the edge enhancing, I'm gonna go for the whatever the default is. You can tell how much is the. Also, what it does is the edge is kind of the edge detection plugin only like really finds the edges of the objects. So what it does, it blurs the selection channel, the mask, and then uses levels to bring the white back. And so this defines how wide you want the selection for the filter to apply to. So I'm just going to go for this. You can actually see what it's doing. It's composite it. So you have you can see that it created like a grayscale copy of the layer below and assigned the mode to only affect the value and not the colors. There's a compositing overlay mode for affecting only the value channel. The advantage of that, I can't cancel it. I should have toggled this parameter off so that I'm not going to do it again. But if I would deselect that, I would have the layer that the filter created available so that I could control the opacity and that way pretty much affect the amount of the sharpening that's available to me, so I could just rotate this thing again, but do that, and do it again. So we sharpened the image. Okay, and now, how much time do I have? Okay, so we can save this and have the original. Okay, so it's saving twice. Okay, I managed to get him to save the file twice and then ask me whatever. Okay, so then I'm pretty much done with the image. I will check that I have a tag correctly. I don't. I have two spellings of Nuremberg, so that I do two. Flower, and that's it. I usually tag images that I've exported onto web with a tag web, so that I can quickly see what kind of stuff I'm having publicly, and it's useful. And I can export this to Flickr, for example, which is a Yahoo-owned service. The free account gets you some limitations of how much, in terms of space, you can do in a month and how many photos you can upload. But when I've evaluated it, it never like limited me very much. And there's a social aspect to that site that people comment on your photos and you see what other people have created. And it's kind of nice, so I think it's worth paying $5 per year or something. It's kind of nice service, but there's other services I'm going to show you. So you could choose to export tags or not export tags, to shrink the image while you're exporting. And should have opened up an image in browser tab. I'm just going to reload this and hope that it worked. Because it's a demo and things break once in a while. It is, but usually it like pops up a window asking you to check things. You can see that I still have the image name. F-Spot doesn't allow to change the title of the image yet, but the tags got exported. Yes, the description would get exported. I can really show the labeling stuff. We can see that all the tags that. I did that on purpose because I usually don't remember the spelling. So very quickly you can get your photos online, and it's not only Flickr, you can export to very, very popular gallery system. It's called Gallery. then there's a very colorful, it's kind of not labeled nicely, but you can export either if you just want to scale your images to, you know, use them somehow. You can use the export to folder, or it allows you to create a static web gallery. And thanks to GNOME VFS, you can actually like export to SFTP, SSH location, and bookmark that, and so that I could have my server listed in here, and I could export directly to the server and not do anything more. There's something I actually wrote. It's kind of the only difference between my tool and all the rest is that it looks nice. You don't have to use that spot, but it kind of creates this sort of gallery. Some stuff like this, localized and stuff. But I don't really maintain that much, so I can't recommend you use it, but you can. And then there's other popular services like Google Picasa. I think I have an account there as well, so we can pull that as well. No gallery. I don't know my desktop system, so I didn't set it up. Oh, yeah, and Google keeps changing the API. Okay. So that's that. Another common thing that I fix with my photos is fixing perspective tilt. You know, people buy very expensive shift lens to get rid of, you know, the fact that you're not being at the same level as the building you're taking pictures of, so you get something like this. You know, it all like shifts to the what do you call that, perspective point, whatever. So we want to, you know, fix this. So we do that by again opening it again. And there's a tool called Perspective Platform, which has a special mode where whatever you do, it does the opposite. So what we do is, it gets in the way. We sort of align the new lines.
Yeah, my goodness.
Spend too much time with is corrected, and I transform. And what it does, it does the opposite, so it compensates for whatever I've designed here. Usually you also need to scale it up, which I do, because you know, when you just stretch things like this, it will appear, you know, shifted like this. But doing that in the corrective mode is kind of guessing, so it's better to use the scale tool.
Whoever designed these icons.
I keep the image preview on this time so that I actually see how the thing looks. So this is not very precise, I'm just guessing here. But and for this kind of image, I would go black and white, so I can show you the channel mixer, how you can get control of. A good thing for some photos is to get rid of. I didn't click on. Does it have that? I thought that there's like a crop the final result toggle somewhere. never mind. So I usually like to get rid of the, because it's still, the layer contains all the data that's there. But if you know, use some filters, they kind of tend to, like for example, the script to do the smart sharpening, it will shift because of, you know, the layers being wider than the image and stuff. So I usually just go image and where's image? And then I want to use the channel mixer. What is it?
Where did your image size
go? Yeah, there's many ways to do the same thing. And I want to do the channel mixer, which is components, channel mixer. So instead of like mapping the individual layers, I click on this thingy. There's, you know, multiple ways I can get the grayscale image. You can change the mode to grayscale. You can desaturate the image. And, you know, they use different algorithms, you know, how much of red is being used there, how much of green, or they just use the value channel and stuff. But with this tool, you get control, for example. It's kind of, you don't know. You just experiment, which is nice. See, well, what about the red channel? The thing I did now is I've decreased the red channel. There's lots of stuff on the red channel.
Why is it?
And there's a toggle to preserve luminosity so that if it doesn't add up, you know, to my original brightness of the image, it compensates with
so that I could decrease red. Oops. Why is only red? So, why is it? Yeah, let me do this.
And just see. There's actually a way to preview the channels. GIMP has. I wonder if it will work if I just do this. You could preview the individual channels here, but by default you can see that GIMP actually uses, you know, the color value for the preview. So if you would like to see this as a grayscale image, you would have to change it somewhere.
It's a middle arrow thing at the top right above the channels.
This?
Yeah.
And I was thinking about, you know, changing the color of the preview. Okay, yeah, so I would have to duplicate this. I'll duplicate color channel. And show it. Never mind. Forget it. It doesn't work. So I can preview it from here. So I can see that the green channel looks like that. The green channel looks like that. So, you know, I prefer to experiment and see, you know, to get decent texture here. The stairs are nice. And and of course, at the end, I will sharpen the image, which is filters, enhance, smart sharpening. And I will remember to toggle this off. Yeah, this is a very slow machine. It's 2 years old and it was fast. On your desktop machine, it will fly. Guys, if you have any questions, shoot, because I'm...
Do you need a microphone?
No.
Okay.
F-Spot, you mentioned that it can't change the title. Do you know if that's planned in the future? That seems really...
Maybe... You know, I'm probably guilty. I haven't really requested that.
I've looked for it several times, and I haven't been able to find it.
Yeah, there's the maintainer, Larry Ewing, and there's two other guys that are very active, and they really, like, every time I have a request, pretty much all the time, they do stuff for me. So I'm pretty sure that, you know, the type of thing gets fixed. What is it? Yeah, so control how much of the sharpening I want to see. Of course, it takes a while. Yeah. Wow. One thing I forgot to mention is a lot of people have raw workflow. Their cameras take like the image that goes directly from the sensor chip. And why is that even more useful? Because they have higher bit depth, and for example, you know, if you screw up with white balance, you can always fix it later, because you know white balance happens in the camera after it gets the picture. So it gives more control, and if you like do slightly bad exposure, there's a better chance that you can fix it. But F-Spot does somewhat support you will be able to import it, you will be able to preview it, you will be able to like do color modifications, but it will it won't take it.
Any of the different
steel and
raw files, just it does support.
Really?
Yeah, that's so. Why I didn't do a demo, because I would have been.
Okay. But it would be possible, for example, to manage your photos with F-Spot. The very good thing that F-Spot does with JPEGs is that you can make F-Spot save the main data as XMP, I think, into the JPEGs. And why is that good is it takes a little longer when you're working tagging the files, but it's definitely worth it because the metadata stays with the JPEG, and you have the freedom to, you know, work on the image in other management software. The KD guys have got like DigiCam, I think. I don't know if it's supposed XMP, but you know, proprietary software like Lightroom does support XMP. So if you import your photos, you can have the same set of photos and work on them in both, you know, Lightroom and F-Spot. And F-Spot does support XMP import. When you import things, it will create the text for you. What is it?
There's no sidecar, which is required if you have a raw, very raw.
Yeah. Raw workflow is not ideal. You can kind of work with it, you can manage them, and you can edit the photos in different software, but then usually when you edit, for example, in GIMP, there's a plugin called US Pro, so you could do that, but the result, again, cannot be a high bit depth image. You still have to choose some, for example, PNG or JPEG. And then I don't think that F-Spot will deal with the change of the file name. So what versions are essentially are just copies of the file, you know, saved as whatever the new version is called. So that you would have to do. The good thing with F-Spot is that it's the database file is just the SQLite database. So even, you know, people like me can do scripts and export and copy stuff just using simple SQL. And you know, you can kind of have a script to for GIMP, not only to save the image to a JPEG, but also, you know, point F-Spot to change the URL of the image to this. So it is possible to have like a, this weird raw workflow, but I'm just waiting for the guys to finish the real raw workflow. And I think I'm being told now, so I thank you for attention.